The civil rights movement in the 1950s and 60s was about equality and justice. It was about the right to vote, to buy a house, to sit in a restaurant, to ride at the front of the city bus, or drink from any water fountain you wanted to. But the struggle for equality was also about money, about economic opportunity long denied. We talked with three African American families about their economic struggles. They aren't famous, but they are part of Georgia's history.
Come on, Lee. Lee, come on.
Felder Daniels was born on this farm near Americus in southwest Georgia. He has lived and worked here all his 57 years.
I like farming. Like I said, it's a way of life. It's a good life. It's not easy, but it's a good life.
His parents were sharecroppers. Sharecroppers, both black and white, farm someone else's land, usually for a white landowner. At the end of the year, a sharecropper would get part of the profits, but often there were no profits, and the sharecropper owed money to the landowner.
Sometimes when you're sharecropping, the owner will always continue, you know, keeping you in debt, so you cannot move from that place, so you cannot better yourself.
The Felder's grandparents dreamed of buying their own farm. And after years of saving and sacrifice, the Daniels family finally bought this land in 1939, all 101 acres of it. They were the first black family in Sumter County to own a farm.
Well, it felt like that it was doing something for themselves, you know, and whenever you get something, feel like you're doing something for yourself, you feel like you're going to have a better future, better life in the future years, you know.
When Felder was growing up, his family raised cotton, corn, peanuts for the money they would bring. But farmers need credit to stay in business. They had to borrow money to buy land, equipment, seed, fertilizer to grow a crop. Before civil rights legislation, Daniel says banks were reluctant to loan money to black farmers, afraid they couldn't keep up the payments.
There's a lot of time when blacks have land and they feel that if they cannot get finance, if the lender feel that they cannot get financing, that they would lose this farm and they could come in possession of it. And that is in some parts of South Georgia, I know that is happening too.
In 1940, there were more than 250,000 African-American farmers in Georgia. Today, there are only about 1,200.
And they had a hard time, particularly with the acquisition of credit. And that was what was really spelled the death knell of black agriculture. They just couldn't get the credit.
Felder Daniels worries about the future of his farm. His children have their own plans for their future. Farming isn't among them. Before she died, Felder's mother made him promise to keep the farm in the family.
Well, she used to tell me that, you know, getting this farm wasn't easy, and that she didn't ever want to see anything happen to it, you know. And as long as, you know, that I can farm this land, like I told my dad, that I'll farm it as long as I'm here.
Okay, come on now. Yeah, I'll take you. Come on here.
Today, Tena Butler's young cousins don't have to face the kind of discrimination she faced years ago.
Come on.
When she was young, this spunky Savannah woman lived with prejudice and segregation, and she fought against it.
That system set up, I guess, at that time, we didn't know why. We were just trained and taught that that was what happened. We knew no difference then. We expected nothing different. You like that picture? Okay. Ooh, now, look at that.
Tena Butler went to a black school. Her textbooks were old hand-me-downs from the white schools. Her parents taught her there were places she couldn't go, things she couldn't do.
It being small, that we were told, you can't go there, you can't drink here. And then when I began reading and could see the word colored, and my parent would tell me, now that's colored people. And you have to drink water here, you have to go here.
Tena Butler warned her children that stores like Woolworths were off limits. Cresses, Grants, Silvers, those segregated stores along Broughton Street are all closed now.
It was a part of life at that time, and we accepted it as such until someone grew a picture of it and thought it was the wrong thing to be done and decided to do something about it.
Tena Butler joined the NAACP. She marched and picketed segregated businesses.
It was determination that no matter what it took to make the change, we were willing to do it. Without any fighting, we were spat on, we were pushed and shoved, but we never shoved back, right here in Savannah.
She also helped desegregate Tybee Island Beach with what was called not a sit-in, but a wade-in. She remembers the song they sang that day.
Wade in Tybee, children, wade in Tybee, children, wade in Tybee, children. Look at the Browns as they wade in Tybee, brown skins wading in Tybee.
She protested, but she still had to make a living and pay the rent. Tena Butler worked at the big Union bag mill as a cashier in the company cafeteria, a segregated cafeteria. Her white co-workers threatened to stop eating there if she didn't stop her picketing.
And a man by the name of Mr. Fitzgerald was the leader, was the head of the boss of the cafeteria department. And I was called in to either come off the picket line or he'd have to let me go. And of course, I was determined, and I chose to let go.
Tena Butler made a courageous decision when she resigned her job because she was divorced with four children to feed. Eventually, she got another job, and she raised a successful family and moved on with her life. Today, she isn't bitter. She remains positive because, she says, of her faith.
We sang that song, Don't Turn Back, Wade in the Water, Children. Lord, you brought me such a long way. I know you're not going to leave me now.
I want to give you this word. I'm coming from St. John, first chapter. And in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God.
Lillie Rosser spends her retirement years as an assistant pastor of a church in Atlanta. One of 10 children, a sharecropper's daughter from McDonough, she came to Atlanta in 1963 at the age of 20, looking for work. For years, she cleaned the houses of Atlanta's well-to-do for about $2.50 a day. And one white employer, she remembers, treated her badly, and that hurt.
I thought she was real good at the time, but she told me, she said, now you can't use the bathroom. And she said, the other maid always used this bucket. She went and got that bucket when she kept outside, and she said, when you get ready to go to the bathroom, you go outside, beside the little house they had out there. And you use the bathroom, but you can't use my bathroom.
You can clean it.
I can clean her bathroom, but I couldn't use it.
At night, Lillie cleaned office buildings as a second job. She never went on welfare, despite low wages, four children, and later, a divorce. She talks about buying a dime's worth of liver to feed her family.
And I knew if I got that liver that I could make some gravy over. So I got the liver, which was one small piece. I took it home and I made gravy over it and I made some biscuits and I fed the children.
Over the years, Lillie got better paying jobs. She worked as a seamstress for $40 or $50 a day. But every day, the city reminded her that she was not equal. Riding the bus home from work one day, tired and pregnant as well, a white man refused to give up his seat.
I didn't understand why I could go work, cook their food, see about their children, but when I get out among the rest of them, I was like an animal or something.
All of her life, Lillie Rosser dreamed of owning a brick house one day. She achieved that dream. She worked hard to keep her family together and give them a good start in life. But today, she has no sympathy for those who complain they can't help themselves.
I said, open your hands. So you got five fingers on each hand. Your feet are working. I don't feel sorry for you. You don't have a problem. You know, I made it, you can make it. So, ladies, you can do it if you try.
In 1994, the state of Georgia named the Daniels family the Small Farm Family of the Year.
About Georgia's economic history, there are more stories to tell, so we'll be back. This is Georgia Stories 2. I'm Colin Sedor. Thanks.